Well, good morning and welcome to St Nicholas, Bathampton for our live stream service. Special welcome to Harry and George, two of our junior church members who are tuning in now for YouTube, having been on junior church since 10 o'clock. And to the rest of you and all grown-ups, regular members, visitors, welcome to any student who might be watching for the first time. I'm back at university for a strange start to term at the moment. We're going to be thinking about how Jesus wants us to live in the church, and have a theme of listening to what God says and doing it. Let's pray before I hand over to Anna, who's going to be leading the service. Don't merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves, do what it says. Heavenly Father, please help us to hear you speaking to us now, and not just to let your words wash over us, but to change our hearts and our lives. Help us to encourage one another. It's hard when we can't meet together as normal, but thank you that we're able to be in touch with each other. And so please help us to encourage one another to look to you and trust and follow the Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, thank you, Anna Young, for leading our service this morning. Over to you.
Good morning and welcome to our Sunday service. It's great to have you with us. We begin our service with some words from the letter of James. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. This morning we're thinking about how the message of the gospel changes our hearts and our minds and our actions, and how we can be listening well to God's word and acting on it. Our first song calls us to lift our eyes to Jesus, the focus of the Bible's message, and the one who saves us from sin, so that we can live to please God.
Thank you.
Well, when I was on holiday in Cyprus a few years ago, I found this sign. I'll show you up close for a second. It's got a picture of a soldier on it, and it says in 5 different languages, "Forbidden Zone." So, as long as you can understand Turkish, or Greek, or French, or English, or German, or even if you can't understand any of those things, as long as you know what a soldier looks like, you get the idea from this sign that you probably shouldn't walk past it. So when I saw this sign, I had a choice. I could look at it, see the barbed wire above the gate, and just think, ah, that's a nice sign telling me not to go over there. But then I could just carry on walking through the gate and off into the forbidden zone with the soldiers. If I did that, I sort of would have listened to the sign, but I also would have completely ignored it, and I would have been in danger. My other choice when I saw this sign, which would have been much safer, would be to read the sign, see the barbed wire, and stay out of the forbidden zone, stay away from the soldiers with the guns. If I did that, I would have listened to the sign, and I would have really listened to it and done what it was telling me to do. As you can probably tell from the fact that I'm sitting here talking to you, I didn't go past the sign, and so I didn't have to explain to myself to any soldiers with guns. And that sign is a little bit like the Bible verse we had at the start of the service. Here it is again. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. When we listen to the Bible, we can do it in 2 different ways. We can listen to the words that are there and think, that's nice, and then carry on exactly the same as before. The Bible says, if we do that, we're deceiving ourselves. We think we've listened to God, but actually, we've ignored him. The other way to listen to the Bible is to hear what it says, and then do what it says. To let what we hear change what we think about God, and to let it change what we think about ourselves, and to let it change what we think about the world around us, and then to let it change the way we think and talk and act. The second option can seem much harder, listening and then acting, but the Bible tells us that following Jesus is a really good thing to do. Our next song is all about the Bible and how it can change us.
Christ that makes us new. Know the the Son of God, the Word whose word is true. Our King has spoken to us, so there is no place for pride. He gives hearts of flesh and changes us inside. It's a light and a hammer, it's a fire and a sword. It's the voice of our Father, the word of the Lord. The blade of the Spirit can cut to the soul, and God will use it. It's a light and a hammer, it's a fire and a sword. It's the voice of our Father, the word of the Lord. The blade of the Spirit can cut to the soul, and God will use it to make us whole.
Well, earlier this week, I caught up with Tim Conn, one of our home group leaders, to hear about his experience of regular Bible reading. So let's listen to what he had to say. Morning, Tim. So you've been at St. Nick's for a couple of years, is that right?
Just under 2 years.
Great. Do you want to tell us a bit about what you do when you're not at St. Nick's and the rest of your week?
I pay the bills by working for a group of hospitals in America. I work with data primarily, so when all's going well, I'm helping them increase their efficiency and quality of care with data.
Right.
And I'm married to Anne-Marie,
okay.
Who works as a patent attorney. And when I'm not at work or at church, I like riding my bike and making pizza.
And you've got a pizza oven, is that right?
Yes.
So we should all come round to you for pizza when we're allowed in each other's houses again.
Yeah, you'd be very welcome.
Thanks very much. And in Sunday's service, we're thinking a bit about the Bible and how we let it change us. What's your experience of doing that?
As a teenager, I heard a talk which convinced me to read the Bible every day. And I've been doing that pretty much every day since then. And I think that's been really helpful to me as I've grown in my faith over the last decade or so. So other than reading the Bible every day, the penny dropped for me when I realized that the Bible is God's book and God is the main character of the Bible. So when we read it, it's this overarching story of God redeeming a people to himself. And when you see that arc in that narrative, it helps me to kind of make sense of where I am in the Bible, and it helps me to see God's character and what that means for me in my life as I read it.
Thanks, that's a really helpful way of thinking about it. So as we find out more about what God is like, we will want to change and be changed. Have you got any practical tips for how we might do that?
Yeah, thanks, I've got a few. So prayer is really helpful in conjunction with reading the Bible.
Hmm.
I think God promises the Holy Spirit to help us understand his word. And the Holy Spirit will convict us of our sin and help us to become more godly and Christ-like. So we're not on our own when we read the Bible, and I think that's really important to remember. The second thing is there's loads of really great resources out there. So tying into God's Big Picture narrative, there's a really good book by Vaughan Roberts called God's Big Picture, and there's a website as well that I'd recommend people looking at, godsbigpicture.co.uk, which has amazing resources in helping us understand how the Bible fits together. And then the last thing I would say is really helpful is reading the Bible with other people. It could be one-to-one with a friend, or a home group is also really great at making sure that I am getting the most from the Bible when I read it.
Thanks very much. Yeah, I'd echo that about chatting things through with other people. It's often a really helpful way of understanding more clearly and more deeply what the Bible means for us. Well, thanks very much for your time, Tim. Enjoy
Thank
the
you.
Rest of your work day. And
yes.
See you at Zoom Coffee on Sunday.
Yep.
Well, Tim mentioned a few different things that he finds helpful in listening to the Bible. And the first was reading it on a regular basis. If that's something you'd like to get into, then you might want to try Explore Bible Reading Notes. They take about 15 minutes each day, and you can get them on an app for your phone or tablet, or you can buy them on paper as well. If you'd like to see a bit more about how the Bible fits together, then God's Big Picture is the book and the website that Tim mentioned. Also, you might like to join a home group. Ours looks a bit like this at the moment because we meet on Zoom. We meet every fortnight and we chat about the sermon and we think a bit more about how it applies to our lives. Finally, if you're not quite as old as Tim, you might like the Action Bible. I know a few of our junior church families are big fans. It's a picture Bible, which is really great for probably primary age children, maybe slightly older as well. And if you've liked Colin and some of his songs, you might like to download some of them or get a CD perhaps for the car. Lots of his songs are based really closely or even exactly on the Bible. So they're really helpful for getting God's word into our heads and our hearts and thinking about it as we go about our day. Well, when we think about God's word and our lives, we know that often we don't listen to him and we don't obey him. And so it's right that we confess our sin. Let us return to the Lord our God and say to him, Father, we have sinned against heaven and against you. We are not worthy to be called your children. We turn to you again. Have mercy on us. Bring us back to yourself as those who once were dead, but now have life through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Father forgive us by the death of his Son and strengthen us to live in the power of the Spirit all our days. Amen. Well, junior church has already happened, so if you are a bit younger, you might like to entertain yourselves for a bit while we hear a bit more about, from the Bible and listen to the sermon. Our psalm for today reminds us of how great God is and of what a blessing it is to live in relationship with him. Do join in or listen as I read it now. Praise the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Who can proclaim the mighty acts of the Lord or fully declare his praise? Blessed are those who act justly, who always do what is right. Remember me, Lord, when you show your favour to your people. Come to my aid when you save them, that I may enjoy the prosperity of your chosen ones, that I may share in the joy of your nation, and join your inheritance in giving praise. Before we have our readings, we're going to sing our next song as a prayer that God will use his word to speak to us and to change us.
Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive. Be seen today in a realm. your glory.
Now, Alex McLaren is going to read our two readings for today. The sermon's going to be on the New Testament reading, so if you've got your own Bible, now would be time to turn to Matthew 18 so that you can follow on while Jonty is preaching.
The Old Testament reading is taken from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 7, verses 1 to 7. This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Stand at the gate of the Lord's house and there proclaim this message. Hear the word of the Lord, all you people of Judah, who come through these gates to worship the Lord. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Reform your ways and your actions, and I will let you live in this place. Do not trust in deceptive words and say, "This is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord." If you really change your ways and your actions and deal with each other justly, if you do not oppress the foreigner, the fatherless, or the widow, and do not shed innocent blood in this place, and if you do not follow other gods to your own harm, then I will let you live in this place, in the land I gave your ancestors, forever and ever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The New Testament reading is taken from the Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 18, verses 15 to 20. If your brother or sister sins, go and point out their fault, just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. But if they will not listen, take one or two others along, so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If they still refuse to listen, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen even to the church, treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. Truly, I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three gather in my name, there am I with them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus is laying the foundations for a community of faith, the church, as he teaches his disciples in this teaching block in Matthew's Gospel. Let's turn to it, Matthew chapter 18. And it's such a privilege to belong to this community of faith, the church, a local church, the body of Christ, which is part of one worldwide body through the ages, as we often say in the Creed, the communion of saints, as we, like previously lost sheep, have been brought and sought and found and brought home by the Good Shepherd. Our theme verse for 2020, I've got the theme verse card up here. You've probably got one of these if you've been a member of the church since the start of the year. It says, "Let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." But what if we find we don't want to meet together? What if we don't find it encouraging? Maybe church is a place of pain for some people. Maybe we've been hurt by someone in the church in the past. Maybe that's not just a past, but a present reality. And lockdown has been a relief, being distanced from this community, the people of God. What can we do about that? Does it really matter? The vicarage in Bathampton has two very prolific apple trees, which I can just about see out of the window here. One of them of cookers and one of eaters. And the first summer we lived here, the branches were bowed down to the ground under the weight of fruit, not having been pruned for a while. And we gathered up buckets of windfalls and picked more bucketfuls and tried to store them through the winter. We wrapped them up in newspaper and tried to make sure they observed social distancing. But each box would have one bad apple that would spread the rot to all the others. And since then, I've been learning year by year how to prune and shape the trees, when to thin and pick the fruit, and how to avoid them all going bad. I'm sure some of you have got apple trees and are probably already experts in this. We gradually tried different ways of storing the apples, putting some on trays. If you keep an eye on them and keep turning them, you can spot as one is going bad and chuck out the one bad apple to protect the rest. And then we might think, that's what we need to do in church. If there's one bad apple, someone who's always causing trouble, gossiping, winding people up, getting everyone down, we need to get rid of them and the church will be fine. But there's a problem with that approach. We saw last week that we are all more needy than we think. Sin is more serious than we think. And Jesus is more gracious than we think. And the problem is the whole flipping church congregation is made up of wandering sheep that have been brought in. You and I are all partly bad apples. Last year, I broke my neck and had the whole summer on sick leave. I was unable to do very much at all, but every day I had a little wander around the garden and looked at the apple trees. I observed and learned. And here's one of this year's apples. Gonna enjoy eating that later. It looks a lovely one. But some of them, can you see this sort of black area around the stalk? And they have little black bits. I don't really know what they are, but often it seems to be associated with an earwig. Incidentally, in our household, we're great admirers of the Welsh accent for speaking English and have been wondering how the English word earwig is pronounced over there. I know there are some Welsh experts in the church, so maybe you could text in an English pronunciation guide later on at the end of the service when we have text. Sorry, I digress. Often when an apple goes bad, you find an earwig in it. But if you catch the earwig early and flick it off so the birds can eat it, there's no lasting damage to the lovely apple. So how do we deal with the earwigs on the apples of our church family life? I think for too long we've been letting them burrow in, letting things fester and rot, and we've not been taking seriously the words of Jesus in Matthew 18. 15 to 20, and now it's time for us to take this very seriously. This can transform our church life. This can make St. Nick's a community that love each other, that genuinely encourage each other, a community that don't just grit our teeth to come together or go for virtual coffee, but that really want to be together. And find it sadly frustrating at the moment that we can't be together as much and in the ways that we would love to, but that frustration itself being a healthy sign of healthy love for one another. That is attractive and will be attractive to the world around as people see the effect of the love of Christ on his people. They will want to join us. Now look at verse 15. If your brother or sister sins, some manuscripts of the Matthew's Gospel add the words "against you" here, which is what the old church Bibles say. If your brother or sister sins, go and point out their fault just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. Now let's ask some questions about that. Who is it that is to act? Who's to act? And the answer is you. Jesus is speaking to his disciples, and it's the person that's been sinned against, if the extra words "against you" turn out actually to have been in the original, or more likely, I think, any Christian who notices a Christian brother or sister sin. Jesus is not giving instructions for church leaders here about church discipline. It's for everyone. He's not saying your leaders should do this. He's saying you should do this. Another question, who do you tell about it when someone sins? The answer is the person who has sinned or is still sinning. Notice what Jesus doesn't say. Not tell nobody, keep it secret. Not tell everybody else. Not tell the rector and hope he does something about it. But privately, go and talk to the person about it. Why do you tell them? To win them over. It's for their sake, to help them. Not to pick a fight. Not to prove your superiority because you haven't sinned in this way. Not to drive the person away in shame, but do it out of love for the person, to win them over. And in most cases, they are won over, and that's it. That's the end of the episode. It's no big deal, no extraordinary thing in the life of the church. It's an everyday occurrence. This should be happening all the time. All of us sin, which is very serious for all of us. All of us help one another out of sin. And this may well be happening more than we see because it's private and its effects are so positive. If the person is won over, nobody else will see. Let me give an example. I left somebody off the distribution list of a group email that I sent to a whole lot of people in the church. It wasn't a deliberate omission, it was an oversight. Nevertheless, it was a hurtful thing for the person left out of the loop. Somebody notices that I've got this thing wrong, I've made that mistake. What are their options then? Well, they could do nothing. They could tell everybody what an unkind, mischievous, or careless rector we have. Or they could tell me. If they choose either of the first two options, the problem grows for the person who was hurt and as more people pick up on that bad feeling. Thankfully, somebody did tell me. I was then able to apologise to the person that I had hurt, explain, ask forgiveness, make sure they got the email, and I could be careful not to make the same mistake again. Until somebody told me, I was unable to do any of those things because I didn't realise what I had done wrong. Now, that was a simple error, but sometimes we might see a more worrying pattern of behaviour. Suppose you notice I was tending to flirt with someone other than my lovely wife. What would you do? Nothing? Mention it to someone else? No, this is a pattern of behaviour with the potential to grow into something disastrous for me, for our family, for our church. You should quietly and privately point it out to me. And then I might say, oh yes, you're right. Gosh, I'm being a fool, aren't I? I need to stay well away from that road. Thank you for pointing it out. Sometimes mentioning it is hard to do. The easy option is to say nothing. There's a pain barrier. There's fear of how the person might react. Am I getting involved in something when I should be minding my own business? The other easy option is to tell other people. Well, that allows the sin to fester and grow just as much as doing nothing, but with the added destructive effect of it spreading wider. Jesus is realistic. It may end happily at this stage. The person, on the other hand, might just laugh, get defensive, counterattack, or ignore you. It may not end happily. And then what? Well, Jesus gives three further steps. In verse 16, but if they will not listen, take one or two others along so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. Not drop it, not tell everyone about it, but slowly and definitely escalate. What's the aim now? Well, the aim is still the same, to win the person over. But it is also now to be clear, this is not just a difference of opinion. It's not okay to carry on and forget about it. The idea of two or three witnesses, Jesus quotes Deuteronomy 19:15 from Old Testament law, should be enough to bring them to their senses. Multiple testimony is much more convincing than one person's comment. I often hear someone say, lots of people think this. But if I don't hear those other people, it's much easier to ignore. This is the kind of way that people get somebody to acknowledge an addiction and seek help. Because if you tell someone that they're drinking too much, they might laugh it off. But if all their family and friends tell them one after another how hurt they are at the damage the drink, the excessive drinking, is doing, the person eventually takes notice. The aim in following what Jesus says here is not to prove I was right, is not to humiliate the person, is not to drive them away. The aim is to get them to listen. And if they do listen, great. That's the end of it. The earwig is off the apple and the apple is still edible. Again, others don't need to hear about it, so this may be happening more than you realise. But if they still won't listen, they need to be warned that you're not just letting it drop there as if it doesn't matter. Remember, Jesus taught that sin is more serious than we think, and he is more generous. This is how he wants us to imitate the Good Shepherd and bring back the wanderer. Verse 17, if they still refuse to listen, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen even to the church, treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. What do we do next? Tell the church. Not the newspapers, not all your Facebook friends, the church. Some churches have a clear discipline policy and a members meeting. This is probably a general weakness of Church of England churches like ours with less clearly defined membership. But if we ever get to this stage with a church member, we might need to tell the annual meeting or the prayer meeting as the biggest gathering of the whole church that doesn't include visitors from outside the church. All our Sunday services are public meetings and may not be the appropriate forum for this. The aim in going to this stage of telling the church, which Jesus is prescribing in advance as he's laying down foundations for how a church should operate, the aim is to win the person over and restore them to fellowship in the church following Jesus. The aim is not to humiliate them, not to prove a point, but to win them over. Not to drive them away, but to win them over. But if they still won't listen, there is no further sanction beyond the next thing Jesus says. There's to be no coercion, no torture, no imprisonment, no burning at the stake. The church has gone wrong in those areas in the past. There is what is sometimes called excommunication. Treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. The Greek is literally, let them be to you as a pagan or a tax collector. And proverbially, that means keep away from them as all good Jews would. This doesn't mean that Jesus approves of the Jews' practice of keeping away from tax collectors. Jesus himself ate and drank with them, but he quotes the proverbial expression as we might say, send them to Coventry, without having anything actually against the city of Coventry. It means we no longer have fellowship with them as a member of the church, a brother, sister in Christ. This is not condemnation. The hope is still that they will be brought to their senses, but if they're not, the sin can't just be left to fester in the church. It has to be taken seriously, as Jesus said in last week's passage. Otherwise, it will spread and bring ruin in the church. Does the church have a right to say this to its members? Yes. Verse 18 echoes what Jesus said in chapter 16, verse 19 to Peter. Verse 18, truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Now Jesus is saying to all his disciples what he had said to Peter when he made the great confession of faith. If it's based on that solid confession of Jesus as the Son of the living God, the church is binding and loosing, declaring what is right and wrong, will be found to have been decreed in heaven. It will be consistent with what God has already decreed. The church, Jesus's community, is that important. When two or three of us are together in his name, he is with us. When those two who were disagreeing come to agree together, Jesus approves of it. It's right with him. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, forgive us for our neglect of this area of your teaching. Forgive us for dealing wrongly with other people's sin, for just ignoring it and leaving them going down a destructive path, for allowing sin to fester and spread in the church, or for talking about it to others and gossiping about it but not actually dealing with it. We're sorry for that. We want to see our church become a healthier community of people that love each other more and that live lives more pleasing to you. And so we ask you to help us to encourage one another Help us to challenge one another. Help us to receive challenge from one another with grace and repentance. And make us a more loving and pure community, shining as a light in the world and showing the difference that your love and grace have made to us and can make to a watching, needy, lost world. For your glory. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to our Sunday service.
Good morning, Anna. I think we got the wrong bit from Anna there. Let's go on to the next bit.
Thanks, Jonty. Our next song is a chance to reflect on what we've been hearing from Jonty and to respond by saying to God that we want to live for him in light of all that he has given us.
Of my mouth and the thoughts of my heart, bless your name, Jesus. And the deeds of the day and the truth in my way, speak of you, Jesus. For this is what I'm glad to do. It's time to live a life of love that pleases you. And I will give my all to you. Surrender everything I have and follow you. I'll follow you. But will you be my vision? But will you be my guide? Be my hope, be my light, and the way. And I look not for riches or praises on earth. Only you'll be the first of my heart. For this is what I'm glad to do. It's time to live a life of love that pleases. This is what I'm glad to do. It's time to live a life of love that pleases you. And I will give my all to you. Surrender everything I have and follow you. This is what I'm glad to do. I will follow you.
now Emily Peel is going to lead us in prayer.
Let us pray.
God of all hope, we call on you today. We pray for those who are living in fear. Fear of illness and fear for loved ones. May your spirit give us a sense of calmness and peace. We pray for your church in this time of continuing uncertainty. We pray for those who feel isolated by not being able to attend or unable to meet their parents, children, grandparents, and grandchildren. Holy God, we remember that you have promised that nothing will separate us from your love, demonstrated to us in Jesus Christ. You are the same loving God who comes to us in our sufferings and opens up the way to new life in Jesus. Help us turn our eyes, our hearts, and our minds to you. Loving God, if we are ill, strengthen us. If we are tired, fortify us. If we are anxious, help us to consider all the things that you have created, the beautiful autumn colours, the harvest in the fields, and the birds in the air. Help us not to stockpile from the supermarkets. Do not let fear cause us to overlook the needs of others more vulnerable than ourselves. Fix our eyes on you and our hearts on your grace. Help us to always hold fast to the good, to see the good in others, and remember there is just one world, one hope, one everlasting love, with enough baskets of bread for everyone. In Jesus we make our prayer. The one who suffered, died, and was raised to new life, in whom we trust these days and all days. Amen.
We join together in the prayer our Saviour taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. And let's just have another prayer as well for students at this time. Heavenly Father, we pray for all those students who come to Bath in difficult circumstances and having a strange start to term and what is going to be a strange term. We ask for your protection for the staff and the students and the whole community in view of coronavirus. We pray for friendships to grow in ways that are possible under these restrictions, safely and healthily. And we ask for your comfort and nearness for those affected by the going missing of two students and then one of them, their bodies being found. And so we pray in this desperately painful situation for Martin's family and for all those who knew him and are affected by this news, those involved in the pastoral care. Please bring your comfort and strength and hope, and help anyone who is struggling to get the help that they need. In Jesus' name, Amen. Well, my mobile number is up on the phone, so you can send in a text. This is live, so it would be good to be able to read out some greetings to one another or some questions. And some people have been already applying the teaching of Jesus that we've been thinking about and challenging somebody privately over their apparent sin, which is Anna. She was talking about not going past this sign, and then we saw a photo of Anna behind the sign. So what's going on with this, Anna? And Anna has texted me to explain. In case anyone is wondering, the gate in my photo, it was slightly open, and so I was standing behind it without entering the forbidden zone. Sorry for not making that clear. Thank you, Anna, for making that clear now, and thank you those who followed the first stage of Jesus's procedure in Matthew 18, challenged Anna over it, and so all is well. I trust, and that worry that Anna's a lawbreaker hasn't been allowed to grow. Any other texts anyone sending in? If you're quick, I'll be able to read it out shortly. And other notices. 6 o'clock today, we have an actual service physically in church at St. Nicholas's. A communion service for those who would particularly like to gather. It'll be socially distanced. We won't have any wine, but we'll have wafers representing, in lieu of bread and wine, representing Jesus' body and blood for us. And face masks are the order of the day, and social distancing and hand sanitizing. And I look forward to seeing some of you then. Also, in 2 weeks' time, we have our annual meeting. There are two meetings, one meeting of parishioners for the election of church wardens, and we have two nominations. And then the annual parochial church meeting, in which we elect our PCC, church council. It's happening at 4 o'clock on Zoom. If you haven't got the Zoom meeting details, which I emailed out to the update mailing list and are on the church website, do contact me or the church office to make sure you're able to join us through that medium and be part of the annual meeting. In advance of the annual meeting, the electoral roll is revised, and it's been open for 2 weeks for revision. Today is the last chance for getting any revisions in, which means if you need to change any of your details, or you're not on the electoral roll and would like to join, there's an application form on our website. Again, do get in touch quickly if you are having any difficulty with that, but would be lovely to have new members on the electoral roll. If you're already on it and your details haven't changed, you don't have to do anything. Here's a text that's just come in. That's David Peel says, Teddy is adding instrumental to the hymns with his new ukulele. So we put that in the loop before the start of the service next week. But there's a picture of Teddy with his ukulele. I wish I could hear that. Send me a video, Teddy. If you send that by WhatsApp rather than text, it won't cost a fortune. There we are. I think let's go on and sing our last hymn, and then we'll have virtual coffee after that. So do come along and see one another briefly on Zoom. The meeting details will come up on the screen after our hymn. So, Heather, that's a funny thing on the screen there. I don't think we've got any more texts. So, have a good day, everybody. Hope to see you in just a minute on Virtual Coffee. The Zoom details will follow on the screen. And if you're visiting, if you're looking for the first time at St. Nicholas live stream, do please get in touch. There are some contact details in the service description on YouTube, and I've given my mobile number, which you can rewind to if you haven't got that. We'd love to hear from you. Let's pray. May the love of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself. May the joy of the Lord Jesus fill your hearts. May the power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.